This is the district meeting.
Amen.
And of course, the coronavirus changed the way we have service, changed the way we worship. And I thank God that we are yet in the land of living. And we don't give the devil any credit. It all belongs to God. In this meeting here, expected to be a blessing to our district superintendent and our district missionary, those who work in the district. And of course, we're present. I have my offering for the superintendent of $200, and I have an offering for the district missionary of $100. And we have an assistant superintendent, I'm a share $100 with him. I don't know who's going to take the money, but y'all scared to come get it. And so do your level best to encourage their hearts. The Lord will bless you. We're going to the word of the Lord, and I told him I only need 20 minutes. After 20 minutes, you're tired of them anyway. And so I take my 20 minutes. Let's go to the word of the Lord. Lord, place this message on my heart again. It's what I've preached several times, and I'm going to share it again tonight. 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 23 through 28.
Yes, sir.
And we're going to read in your hearing verse 23 and 28. If you don't mind standing for the reading of the word. And the servant of the king of Syria said unto him, their gods are gods of the hill, therefore they were stronger than we. But let us fight against them in the plain, and surely we shall be stronger than they. Then if you skip down to verse 28.
Yes, sir.
And there came a man of God, saying unto the king of Israel, and saying that, thus says the Lord, because the Syrians have said, the Lord is God of the hills, but he's not God of the valleys. Therefore will I deliver all this great multitude into thine hand, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. And I want to talk to you about the God of the hills and the God of the valleys. Without him, I could do nothing. Without him, I would fail. Without him,
we're
thank you, Lord, first of all, for last night's sleep. It wasn't a sleep of death, but you touched me early this morning and awakened me from my sleep. And I want to tell you thank you. Thank you, Lord. I was able to put on my shoes, brush my teeth, and clothe myself without any assistance. And I want to tell you thank you. I don't take you for granted. Thank you for bringing us over the highway safe and sound. Thank you for keeping us in the midst of this virus and the troubles that we have in our country and in the land. But you keep us. You kept us thus far. And we're leaning on you. Now we ask, Lord, that you look on those who are sick and afflicted among us. You give them healing. By your stripes, you can heal the world.
Yes, Lord.
In the name of Jesus. Heal and deliver, set free. Look on Mother Thomas, young.
Yes, Lord.
Those that don't know the Lord, touch their bodies now. Send healing in the womb. Remember the old God. Touch him now, Lord. You are able to do it. All power is in your hand. Remember the good night. In the name of Jesus. All those that don't know the call, send the angel in the room, that healing angel. Touch him now. Raise them up. Lord, in Jesus' name we pray. And we be so faithful to give our name we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Glory, glory. Hallelujah. Same faith that the three Hebrew boys had and that Daniel had, and know that God is able to deliver us, even though it doesn't look like it. I'm sure when they were in the fiery furnace, and when they threw it in the man's head, he heated up several times more. And when they threw me in, they didn't know what was going to happen. They didn't know there was another man in the fire when they got in. But God knew that he had. And he said, it looked like the Son of God. I don't know how. He knew that. He said, he looked like. Remember, God is in the fire with us. He's in the and with us in the midst of this pandemic that we're going through.
Yes,
this virus, this coronavirus, and any other name they call it. COVID-19. We get all kind of names they call it. Amen. But that's just the way. Amen. I didn't know you would be glad to see you. Amen. Y'all. We got the mask. The unmasked. And so the God of the hills and God of the valley. The hills on the mountain represents the best of times.
Right now,
but I believe if I keep on living, I see and how the Lord has brought us out. And so everybody is going through something. If you're not going through, then you've been through. If you haven't been through, you're coming out. And if you haven't gone through, just keep on living. And I will show you that you're going to go through something. The psalmist says in Psalm 34:19, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivered him out of them all. And God, through his permissive will, sometimes allows us to be attacked by the enemy to prove us and to see if we can trust him in the midst of a crisis. And so he can get the glory out of our lives sometimes. I look at this, what y'all call it, coronavirus, and say, if God in control, why would he let this come? He has a permissive will, and who knows what God has done. I know it calls a lot of them to pray. It calls a lot of them to turn around and reflect upon yourself. I shared with y'all your Sunday day. Time to reflect upon yourself. And me and some of y'all sat down at the table with your family. And, you had to sit down alone, and you're going, wife getting up going, you going. And so the man said, stay home. Told you to get off the job today. Yes, stay home when you had to look at each other. You had to sit down and look at them. And even if you didn't want to say nothing, but after you got there 3 days, you had to say something. all things work for the good. Yeah, I mean, we don't mean I'm looking, but that's the truth. And some of them sit down to the table with the family in years. And you going to work 6 and he going 9. And advise Russell and coming back. Amen. I'm off, but I'm gonna leave y'all alone. But when we got there and they say you don't go out, cause that monkey's out, they're gonna get you. And you stayed in. And I know I stayed in. And still they still got me on lockdown. I just come out, I'm glad to get out tonight. So regardless of how dark and gloomy things may seem in your life, you should never set limits on God's ability to deliver you out of whatever situation you're in. I'm still saying God is able. And he has kept me thus far, and he kept you. The Bible says in Matthew 19:26, with God all things are possible with God. Not some of the things, but all things are possible. Then in Ephesians 3:20 says, he's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Our text tonight deals with Israel when they were challenged by one of their worst enemies, the enemy Syria. Syria was Israel's oldest and worst enemy. Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria at that time, had formed an alliance with 32 other kings. 32, with all their horses and all their chariots. And they besieged Samaria. I mean, they surrounded it. And nobody could get out and nobody could come in. Sometimes the enemy surround us and make us feel like we have no hope. But we know that we can put our trust in God and he will bring us out. And so all Israel kings were bad. You know the divided kingdom. I don't know if it's been long, but the kingdom was divided. And Israel was the northern part And all of their cake was somehow just turning back on God. But Ahab, who succeeded his father, Omri, was the most notorious king in all Israel's history. The Bible says in 1 Kings 16:30 through 31, "And Ahab, the son of Omri, did evil in the sight of the Lord above all that were before him. And it came to pass, as if he had been a light thing for him, to walk in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, that he took a wife, Jezebel, the daughter of Ishbel, king of the Syrian, and went and served Baal, and she introduced Baal worshipers to all Israel." And if you want to get in trouble with God, I often say this, and I really mean it, then you start switching gods. And God had told them what to do. Now, I had time to go and all that, but he told them not to make leave, not to marry any of those folk. And of course, they did, and we see what happened. But Benadad and his 32 kings, as I said, besieged Samaria. Samaria was the capital of Israel. And then he didn't let nobody go in, nobody come out. And he sent messengers to the king, Ahab, and said, "Your gold is mine, your silver is mine, your wives and your children are mine." Ahab agreed, assuming that he knew he had lost fellowship with the real God. And so he didn't even put up a fight, he didn't put up a fuss. Say, "That's what you want." He reluctantly agreed to his unjust demand. But how many know the devil not only wants to kill you, but he wants to destroy you? And everybody else that's connected with you. He came to steal, kill, and destroy. But if we resist him, the Bible says, he will flee from us. And of course, Ben-Hadad wasn't satisfied with that. He sent the messenger back. Say, "Tell King Ahab, I not only want his silver and his gold and his wives and his children, but by this time tomorrow, I'm going to send my servants, and they shall search every house in your kingdom and take everything that's pleasing in their sight." Whatever, well, just a little too much for Ahab. He said, "It's all right, you ask for my wives and my children and my gold, but you're going to come and go into all the people now." Ahab called a meeting of the elders of Israel, not knowing what to do. But come on and say, God had a man.
God had a man.
God sent a prophet unto Ahab. And not because Ahab had been faithful and lived in such a righteous way, for all of us know he had switched gods. And we call sin today. So Ahab missed the mark. And I want to say he sinned. But he missed the mark. And he had missed it terribly. But because God's unfailing love and care for his chosen people, you know, that's what the devil does for us. When we make a mistake and look like Mr. Mark, the devil tell you, "Man, we're going out in the world and forget it because you done messed up." And you got to understand that God loves you even when you miss the mark. And he's willing. All you got to do is confess your fault, and he will take you back. He can walk right into the fold. He's just and willing to forgive us. And so he came to his children rescue, not because they had been living so well and had kept the faith, but because he loved them. And come on and tell somebody he loved you. Tell him he loved me. How many times have we missed the mark? But God loved us so. because he forgive us. And this is why I keep on serving him. And I know I've made some mess up. But I'm certainly glad that he's a God that's a forgiving God. God told Ahab to call the battle. And the battle was called strategically at high noon. And while Benadad and his 32 kings were drinking and celebrating the victory even before they fought the battle. And he was so sure that he was going to win. And so he just said, oh boy, let us celebrate before we go fight. And they got drunk celebrating. And God used 32 young men, 7,000 of the other people, women and children, and gave them victory over them guys while they were drunk. When they woke up, Israel had gone through and captured and got the victory. God can work with few or he can work with many. And he had to tell Gideon he got too many. He had 32,000. And he got rid of them when he got out to 300. He said, that's my number. And when God give us a victory, it doesn't mean for us to stop praying. Tell somebody, don't stop praying when you get the victory. That's why Jesus said, men ought to always pray and not faint. But you got to remember the devil is going to come back. And when Jesus went through his suffering, his persecution, his whatever he was going through, fasting and praying. Yeah. And when he got through fasting and praying, the Bible says he left him for what? A season. That means he was going to come back. And I want to tell you right now, every victory you get is another one to win. He may leave you alone for a season, but he'll be back. When he comes back, he'll bring some help. So let the Bible tell us, don't stop praying. The Lord is not. Don't stop praying. He'll hear your cry. So each victory is another one to win. We can't stop praying because of one victory. The war is not over yet, even though we know we're fighting a fixed fight. And look at somebody say, we're fighting a fixed fight. I like that one. It's been fixed. Yeah, they didn't have to pay nobody off. But Jesus fixed it. When he said it's finished, my fight was fixed. The prophet warned Ahab to spend himself. Don't go around bragging on your battle. For the return of the year, the king of Syria is going to come against you again. And Benadad's war strategist, who had analyzed the battle, said, I have studied the thing, and I know why we lost the battle. We lost to those few Israelites. Verse 23 says, you see, their gods are gods of the hill. Therefore, they were stronger than we. But let us fight against them in the plain, get on level ground. And surely, we shall be stronger than they. And what it was saying, they had them chariots. And see, Israel didn't have no chariots. They were on foot. And they were, it's hard to drive a chariot up the hill and downside the hill. And so they said, that's why we lost. The devil would give you some false premise. But they didn't understand that it was God with them and fighting the battle. It wasn't Israel, it was God. And they were fighting the battle. So they said, now this time let us get on the plane, get on a flat surface, and we'll be stronger than they. 24th verse says, and do this thing. What he's saying, do this, take them kings away. In other words, take them somewhere and send them home. All they've done is drinking. And they got drunk and couldn't fight. And put every man out of his place and then put captains. And somebody you can control. You can control the king, but put captains in their place. Verse 25, and number thee in the army like the army that you just lost, horse for horse, and it will build your army back like it will, chariot for chariot. And we'll fight against them in the plain. Surely we shall be stronger than they. And he listened, hearken, that word hearken means he listened unto them. You got some folk don't want to listen. And say, that's what's wrong with your brother. Then, nah, he don't want to listen to nobody. But leaders have to listen. They got advice on things. You listen. I'm your leader, but I listen to some people. You don't want to hear me? Yeah. And he hearkened, he listened unto their voice and did what they said do. King Benadad called them out, and they went getting ready to fight. Israel down there like a bunch of kid goats. And this whole big Syrian army ready to come out. In verse 28, and there came a man of God. And God always have a man. And some of y'all don't believe in the man of God. Oh. But God always has, all preachers are not bad. And don't fool yourself. You cheating yourself out the blessing when you fail to talk to the man of God. Y'all hear me? Here the king, God sent the man of God and speaking to the king of Israel and said, thus said the Lord, because the Syrians have said, the Lord is God of the hills, but he is not God of the valley. And why did they say that? And God got all power in his hand. Yeah. He said, I will deliver this great multitude into thine hand. And you shall know that I am the Lord. Has he ever delivered you out of anything?
Yes, sir.
You ought to know what God is, the God of the Bible. He's able to do. And I can tell you tonight that our God is the God of the hill.
Yes,
and he's also God of the valley. And so I think I explained to you what I meant by saying he's God of the hills. He's God of the hills. And he's God of the valley. When I say that he's God of the hill, I mean that he's the God in the best of times. And still God in the worst of times. And he's God when you're on the mountaintop. And I've enjoyed some mountaintop experiences. And I've enjoyed some valley experiences. But when you're on the hill, you're in the best of times. Uh-oh. Able to pay your rent, pay your house note, and 2 or 3 months ahead, and have a few pennies left over. You know, somewhere you get a few pennies in your pocket. You feel better. You say, I don't feel like you're telling something wrong. You feel better. I know I feel better. I feel worse when I'm broke. I just want some money in my pocket. I'm on the mountain walking when I got some money in my pocket. So you're able to pay that house payment. You're able to pay your car note. And you ain't got to worry about nobody taking you. You feel good when you got a job.
Yes,
you're on the mountaintop. Things are going well on the job. You just got a promotion. You come in to preach, you don't have a chance to preach. I just got a testimony. Just want to tell it. They gave me a promotion on the job. And I just want to tell it. Got to tell somebody. Amen. You're on the mountaintop. You're on the mountaintop when your husband got a job and working. And then bring his paycheck home. Uh-oh. You're able to buy some of the clothes that you want to buy. And get that meat that don't steam. Get that fine jewelry. On the mountaintop. It's a mountaintop experience when all your children are doing well. They finish school and become productive citizens in society. And that's a mountaintop experience. But how many know you ever been up on the mountain, but just look down, and there's a valley. And where there's a mountain, there's a valley. And you got to go through some valleys sometimes. And it's a valley experience when you go to your job and they need your pink slip and tell you the job is folding up. And they're going down to Mexico. Yeah, uh-oh. Gone over to Puerto Rico somewhere. The job is gone. And you just bought that house. And you got that new car. You wonder, that's in the valley. You're in the valley. When your children are giving you trouble and they get kicked out of school and they're on drugs and your daughter got pregnant and you brought one home to you, you're in the valley. You're in the valley when you go to the mailbox and you get that foreclosure notice and they're getting ready to foreclose on your house. You're in the valley. I like this one. You're in the valley when you come home in the evening and park your car in front of the house. And go to bed. Get up early in the morning. And get out, get ready to go, and the car is gone. You run back in the house and call the police. Say, you stole my car. Only to find out the repo man came in the middle of the night and took your car. You are in the valley. You're in the valley when you ain't got enough money to pay your bills and telephone and disconnect. You go to the doctor and your health begin to fail. And you get a bad report from the doctor. And the children won't do right. The husband went to 7-Eleven. And getting that little bread. And he ain't coming back yet. You're in the valley. Depression dropping in. You become discouraged. Ready to give up. But I'm here to tell you that the same God that was on the mountain with you, he'll be in the valley. That same God. He's a good God. He's God in the good time. And he's God in the bad time. He said in the word, I will never leave you nor forsake you. You can cast all your care upon him. For he cares for you. So I want to remind you, be not dismayed, whatever betide. God will take care of you. Beneath his wings where love abides, God will take care of you. And I've had many tears and I've had sorrow. I've had many questions about tomorrow. There have been times I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave me blessed consolation that my trials, my heartaches, my battles came to make me strong. So I thank God for my mountain experience. But I thank him for the valley. I thank him even for the storm that he brought me through. For if I never had a problem, I wouldn't know that God could solve it. I never know what faith in God could do. But through it all, come on and say, through it all, I learned to trust in Jesus. I learned to trust in God. Through it all, I learned to depend upon his word. Say it. Right there for you. All you got to do increase and cast the cares on him. And he cares for you. You may be going through some valley experiences in your life right now. You may be dark, but the God that we serve is able. Give it to him and let him work it out. Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you for this privilege and this opportunity. Look on that woman, that man, that boy, that girl that's going through right now. Even lying on the bed of affliction. Maybe the doctor has given them up, but you never give them up. Right now, in the name of Jesus, save the one that's in his hell today. This is our prayer.